Hey guys, so if you're new here, or if you're not, if you want to hear me voice act, head over to our main channel, links down below. And if you don't, this channel's solely for TTS. If you want to know all the details about what's going on, we have a stream up that you can go and watch, but let's just get into the video.
So I'm a Necron Cryptek, so what? Part number 5. Almost there. After all this time, we can finally fix a tomb world. The Canoptech Scorpioid was given blanket approval by Executioner Phileas, and the council really couldn't argue with that matter, which I had hoped I could actually get some field testing in, but okay. Trazin immediately asked that I see to it that 100 units were provided to him over interstitial messaging. I told him we'd make a deal after the mission on a gun. With all the matters dealing, we moved on to the next and hopefully last matter. The Seratech Heavy Construct outside. They had not been active when last I was on your world. Phileas remarked. Ah well, those are awoke not too long after you, I was cut off. These constructs were made by you, were they not? Phileas asked. Just when I thought the hard bit of this meeting was over. I think that is the case. I say with a shrug. You think? Also Aria spat. How is it you don't know? She asked incredulously. I must admit that. When I awoke, I hold the back of my head. My own engrams had gone some changes, worn down by 42 million years residing within a stasis sarcophagus of substandard quality. Most of the crowd seems to quite noticeably flatten at that comment. It would certainly explain my early awakening. All the same, I am still performing my duties, even if perhaps I have forgotten the wider scope of my abilities. Zubica seems pleased with this. Meaning their production is lost to you as well. As shame it is to hear that. Quelka said. Finally we moved on to the final bit of discussion. Our heading to the tomb world of a gun from the Knights of Makrig book. A chronomancer by the name of Nehibkor was alone on that world. 12 years were lost in those expansive talks. Pandering to the Ferak Osuaria. Threatening Lord Nemesis Zubica. Enticing High Metallurgist Quelka. Trizin was a bit of a smooth talker, ensuring me this was all by the book, and sure enough we had made the council yield to our original plan without issue. With the living metal bacteria that permeated their world and my own previous actions, it was only natural that we would absorb the lesser dynasty into our own. God, it felt good to win. The awakened council needed time to prepare assets, 2 decades to prepare. Which in that time I was expected to work on refining and start the production on the Canoptech Scorpioid in time for the voyage. I was actually glad as I would get to work with another Cryptek that followed my vein of research. Osuaria and Zubica would go on to leave the planet. But not before they both bullied me into making them both personally crafted patterns of the new weapons that were just approved of. I was actually content to get back on the crafting phase. I was so close to actually achieving one of my big picture goals. This endeavor could take multiple centuries, but I was fine with that. The years ticked by with me and Metallurgist Quelka working rigorously to produce more of the Scorpioid constructs. Having someone extensively trained in metallurgy was a godsend. We were pumping out entire spools of Auramite thread. We spent years simply discussing the topics of metal. Holy shit, when the fuck did I become such a metal nerd? In other news, most of my crew returned to the ship. I took half a year to cool off after working with Quelka. I really needed to work on the next build of Dawn of War Apocalypse's Elite Edition. For starters, I turned all the flares and destroyers into versions of my modified Immortals and Deathmarks wielding versions of their new weapons. That and I fixed multiplayer to limit one of each Farron. No more Stormlord spam. I quickly found that changes were well received, along with a litany of other bugs that were patched. When I launched the patch, I found a greater influx of Lich goods. And Praetorians, and holy fuck, Phileas was now in on it. The rounds weren't dragging out. I mean, they usually only lasted months in real time, but that's actually quite fast for a Necron. It also seems that the Immortals are actually learning. Which is good. Normally Immortals were unable to learn anything new, that was something heavily noted in the lore. Seems their awakening was actually having some positive unforeseen side effects. Phileas actually seems to be enjoying the game, and is slowly heading to try and dethrone our current reigning champion. First Scythe Gakhat, who has unironically been gaming for longer than I was alive as a human. Speaking of, it's been around 136 years since I woke up. Some of the extra Xenos I added as minor enemies when I had initially made the game had been reworked as I spoke more and more with Trazian about them. The Xenos I had worked had been the following: Clawed Fiends, Crotalid, Jirinx, Jacaro Weaponsmith, Chimery, Croot, Croothounds, Crutox, Medusae, Megarachnids, Razorwing Phlox, Slith, Urgulland, the Vespid. I'll be honest, it was a fun thing adding them in. Some of the orc players were actually finding out that I made a few of the Xeno races recruitable, which made them quite excited to try and tame Jirinx and Jacaro into their ranks. After a few dozens rounds, Executioner Phileas did eventually pull me off to the side. These simulations are interesting, Ishka. I wish to distribute them to my colleagues within the Triarch's Praetorian. It felt like more of a demand. I am seeing active progress within your Immortals and Lich Guard's tactical engrams, something I haven't seen across the thousands of tomb worlds I visited. I guess I can give you both the Battlefleet Gothic Armada game and Dawn of War Apocalypse's Elite Edition. Are they really that helpful? She nodded vehemently. Well, I understand. I will prepare a data scroll with the information needed to run the game. I give her a thumbs up. She tilts her head, and I quickly hide my hand behind my back. Do Necrons not normally give thumbs up? She returns the gesture, which I can only assume is a confused train of thought running through her mind. I quickly retreat into my ship. I think it's best if I cloister myself in my quarters so I can work on her request. I give a quick ping to Chari and Quelka. I'm going to be busy for a few months preparing some data for the Praetorians. I shut myself into my room. I see an odd little scarab in my chamber and I give it a light pat before going to a terminal. It's mostly a matter of transferring over the data into a physical media, as in crystalline data scrolls. These 8-sided cylindrical scrolls can be plugged into most terminals and the data is instantly uploaded from there, like a USB but with far more memory. I'm kind of curious what will come of these games being distributed out to the wider Necrons. Will this actually mean Necron strategy might improve in the long term? I can only hope. I've made the 2 data scrolls needed for Battlefleet Gothic Armada game and Dawn of War Apocalypse's Elite Edition. As I pulled the 2 fresh scrolls from my terminal, volts of electricity jumped off the Fars glyph screen. I tried looking for the source, but immediately something took over the screen. In a hissing spark and crackle, words came onto my screen. Notepads in a crude jagged font. I looked around to see the scarab, the one I modified several decades back. How did? I stood up and approached the scarab. A quick scan showed it wasn't connected to the interstitial link all subservient canoptic constructs fell under. It was a mild oddity. I communed with the scarab for a bit. Learning that it had been another unintended byproduct of my resonance cascade incident. It had the same sort of knack for creation as me, so I gave it few schematic designs to work on. Mostly I was curious to see what it would make on its own. They shared their few interesting designs with me and I assured it, it would be scrapped as it believed it would. I could definitely make use of these canoptic egg structures for some future plans. For now, I return to Phileas. The next 15 years were spent in heavy industry with Quelka. We managed to produce roughly 75 sets of canoptic scorpioid patterns. Which roughly translates to 225 individual units, seeing as the sets came in units of 3. Trazin was allowed to have 25 sets right out of the gate. The rest were going to be dedicated to our effort on a gun. We were finally taking off the planet. This venture would take an 8-year long voyage towards the tomb world of a gun. A shorter voyage, but much of that place was uncataloged and dangerous, as I'm told. Our small fleet consisted of 2 Shroud-class light cruiser, mine and Trazin's, a Cairn-class tomb ship, Executioner Phileas, 2 Jackal-class raiders, and a Dirge-class raider, Quelka's. In that time we spent traveling together, I learned much in my talks with Quelka. I toughed much when it came to the ways of transmutation. In return, he taught me ways to weave metals like I'd never imagined. He taught me the concept of phase hardening, which can reinforce certain metals to another level of durability. Coming to realize it, he just more or less gave me a hint as to how to make one of the Necron relics. In any case, we still have 3 more years worth of travel left. It's a bit grim. I'm so excited to arrive onto a dead world. As we were continuing our heading, I had been receiving a lot more questions as of late from the Praetorian. They had been playing, or as they say, training when they couldn't help but notice an additional options that had not yet existed. The pariah from the Necrons. The snaggers from the orcs. And nearly the entire roster for the Eldari was something the Necrons had encountered. They were expecting Khanite warriors and other units. Fuck. The Eldari of this time have more temples actually dedicated to their gods instead of all these Aspect warriors. It's only natural they don't know what any of the Phoenix Lords or Aspect warriors and their exarchs are. Trazin and Phileas pulled me into a call. Trazin started, "Ishka, while these combat simulations have been most enjoyable during our extended travels, it has come to our attention on multiple occasions you have included various units not currently known to even I." Trazin dramatically placed his hand to his chest. "When previously you asked me to join you in the accurately depicting Xeno combat, I was able to give you extensive data on several races. But even if you presented me with races that befuddled my own memory, this is a vast galaxy, yes, but as one so recently woken. It stretches incredulity for you to have witnessed such Xenos in such a short amount of time." He finished as he narrowed his eyes on me. Phileas was next. "In addition to this, the Eldari you have recorded here are unlike any we have encountered even within the War of Heaven. Consulting Trazin's extensive records, it even seems as though these Eldari do not exist, nor do we in our records hold these pariah you have added. Rural is a great app available on the Apple and Google Play Store as well as desktop for creating beautiful 8-bit character art. The app has 14 supported races, 150 plus weapons, 400 plus armor pieces for you to mix and match, 20 plus mini bases. There is that much to work from. I was able to make Coldsteel the Hedgehog, the God Emperor of Mankind, Pepe, and they are always adding more artwork. The app also has a character sheet to help keep track of everything during games. And if that wasn't enough, you can play about with the app for free with limited artwork. So go ahead, check it out, and if you decide to buy the app, use promo code NICKBEDIA for 10% off and it lets them know we sent you. It's a great sponsor and a great app and we hope you guys go ahead and check it. But let's get back to the video. Calling back to this post 78,617,238. Phileas lowered her head closer to the display, making it so she was leaning closer to the screen. "Have you in all of your foresight seen enemies that do not as of yet exist?" Trazin seemed to chuckle at that. I stood silent. What the fuck could say? I for once voluntarily went quiet for more time than was necessary. After a year of waiting, Phileas snapped at me. "I asked you a question, Ishka. What have you divined that would enable you to see the new might the Eldari possesses?" I finally spoke. I couldn't let my spaghetti overflow this time. "I have seen a galaxy in flames." I began to project images onto the feed instead of letting them see me. "The Eldari in their decadence rupture the very galaxy, birthing forth a god from the Empyrean." I showed the birth of Slaanesh, and the fall of the Eldari into the Elder. "I see a fledgling race reaching for the stars for conquest, butchering untold billions before squabbling across the stars, destroying all in their path." I showed them the Great Crusade, and the heresy in its wake. "I see the green tide waning and waxing at each age, mustering force and ever waging grander war." I showed the Mulana, the Beast, and Armageddon. "I see the coming of God things in the realm of souls, so twisted, so perverted from its former beauty that it births billions of demons." I showed them the Great Rift, the Black Crusades, the forces of chaos, and the Cicatrix Maledictum opening. "I see tides of hungering insects that would consume our galaxy, corrupting the flesh of mortals and infecting all in its own wretched image." I showed them the Tyranids, Worlds Eaten, the Genestlers, and the Patriarchs. "I've seen all of this and so much more, such horrors that would send on into madness, and I wish to prevent that future with every fiber of my being." Trazin had been watching intently, ensuring he saved every single image I had presented. But Phileas seemed to lower her head as to digest it all. "I didn't let up though. I have seen what the Silent King returns to do, while he is away on his self-imposed exile. Returning upon the epoch of the Great Awakening, he was disturbed by the notion of something that would even dare to devour our kind. He only makes half measures, opposed by the Technomond rites. Something stirs at the back of my mind, unsettling so. And our beloved diviner, so gifted with much of this foresight, if nowhere nearly as accurately informed as me. What does he do with millions of years of foresight? He squabbles a star form, he rivals against Trezin, and not once does the cur deign to save a single Necron in the 60 million years he was awake. I have seen so many squabbles amongst our kind, and it sickens me to my core. So many lost to petty dynastic wars, so many more lost to the failure of the stasis chambers, and Shards knows how many taken by the Flayer cults and destroyers. I show them flashes of each of the described events, before finally the Silent King returning to a galaxy in ruins. I slowly fall silent, and take an unneeded breath. Many months pass before Phileas speaks up. This form of stars you speak of, was this from you achieved? The one which seemed to be the birth and death of a star, so many sectors away? Something very close to that, yes. When the stars align over him in 17 million years, he too shall receive a far greater power than I achieved that day. I admit. But I have so much more work to do than await the coming of stars. Trezin was in talks with Sanat about the transdimensional portal linked back to my Tomb World and his own. Phileas would move ahead with Triok Praetorian and 25 sets of the Scorpioids to scout for the higher echelons of Necron Command. Quelka and I prepared an extensive amount of living metal required to restore the populace. This wasn't going to be a breeze, but I already knew that. I looked out to that deep blue planet, and breathed softly. 42 million years had killed so many Necrons. Something here that over the millions of years ate away at the living metal, and rusted the millions of Necrons on this world. How many would be too far gone for us to restore? After a tense 3 days of silence, Phileas pinged us. She had found the site of one of the tomb entrances along the equator of the world. One by one our ships descended from orbit. We broke through the exosphere, followed by our ships slowed by some sort of lull once we broke into the stratosphere. Chronomancy was instantly flagged by our avoidmancer. We continued, pushing through the disruptive field. Our ships touched down in the center of a massive valley that was covered in a thin layer of fog. We sent out our Deathmarks ahead to patrol for any organics. Phileas had informed us of sighting some amphibious megafauna stalking around. Several Doom Scythes were deployed alongside them. Each was going to begin branching out across the various continents to try and find as many entrances into the tomb as possible. Trezin would end up leaving his power generation device in my care. He seemed more interested in securing the megafauna of this world. And so we continued on. Quelka and his vanguard, and my veritable began marching to the tomb that Phileas told us about. We arrived in a timely 10 hours of marching through dense and unforgiving terrain. The sight that greeted me was not a pleasant one. A host of 30 lich good half buried about the entrance of the tomb. Many of them had been eaten away at by who knows form of corrosive elements. I sent my Cantapec Scorpioids begin excavation of those decayed forms. And soon I had the scarab swarms that had been pumped full of living metal at the ready for restoration work. While they were being taken care of, I would approach the tomb entrance. It had been cracked open, relay beacons had been set up nearby by Phileas and her scouting team. I entered, Lich Guard, Wraiths, and a few hosts immortals followed me in. The interior of the tomb was marred by ages of erosion. We walked for miles passing dozens of collapsed chambers. Canoptic constructs caked in rust or crushed by debris from fallen pillars. Our path ahead had been cleared by the scouting team. Precision cuts into the black stone and collapsed chambers had ensured we could progress onwards. We continued following the trail or relays. The deeper we headed, the more we came to see the vile overgrowths in the cavern. Roots had broken through the ceiling and tangled themselves across every surface it could find. I found an unfortunate warrior who was so entangled in the roots that it was growing out from in between its ribs. I was unsettled to say the least. I had my Lich Guard cut the long dead warrior free of the vines, his broken body set off to the side. Our march continued. I received a ping from Phileas. Her Scorpioids had begun detecting activity on the lower floors. She informed me she was going to wait for me to arrive. With that, me and my host came running. I had sent a message back to another set of Canoptech constructs to follow in after us. And to have the Seraptechs to be on high alert while they watched over our ships. It took us another day before we arrived at Phileus' spot. Her team of 30 Praetorians and the 25 sets of Scorpioids was a very reassuring sight. Ishka, we have uncovered a path leading to the deeper tomb. I believe we will be reaching the chambers of the nobility next. She informed me. This was good. I took a moment to think before asking her. Good, have you yet encountered any live Canoptech constructs? She nodded no. As of yet no sightings of constructs have been made. I let out a sigh, well let's get going, Nehebkal waits. We pressed further into the tomb. We were passing so much decay. We moved through a part of the tomb complex that housed a host of immortals. Their necrodermis was caked in rust. Sections seemed as though they had been eroded away. We could see their insides hanging loosely frayed and barely kept in place, entire limbs and heads fallen or reduced to dust. I couldn't find a single stasis sarcophagus that had been turned on. There was nothing here that didn't get touched to the ravaging touch of time. Onwards deeper through a myriad of tombs complexes that mirrored the last. In just a few short days we had passed over a million warriors that had been laid low by decay. It kept us quiet for all that time. So many of us couldn't voice the sorrow or anger we felt, or at least I couldn't. After passing through a hall containing hundreds of immortals we found something actually moving. A single scarab skittering along the archway of the chamber. I pointed it out to Phileus, rapidly shaking her shoulder to look at it. If we get it we can have it lead us straight to the cryptic, Phileus. I said with uncontained glee. Phileus spoke out an override command in the chamber. Right away the scarab came down to address her. She lifted the scarab. Some sort of mental communication was going on that I wasn't privy to. It's as you say, Ishka, a cryptic by the name of Nehebkor is operating in the lower levels. She lifted the scarab higher. Send a message to your cryptic. Aid from the Awakened Council has arrived. The little scarab clicked its small mandibles together and I can't assume it sent the message. After that Phileus had us march deeper into the tomb. She wanted to meet the cryptic halfway. Onwards we rushed. We had the Scorpioids cutting through entire sections of the tomb as it was growing more and more hazardous. Our immortals and Agaklet joined in riddening and obliterating any signs of plant life that hindered our movements onwards. We continued forward through all of this only to reach a clean room. A polished mirror room of a strange substance. This antechamber was quiet and Phileus had us stop here. We could hear the dull drowning of Canoptech constructs from ahead. Slowly we saw the mangled and oxidized Canoptech swarms rush into the room. I had never seen such awful looking constructs. How they had managed to survive. Once the room had filled we could hear the clicking steps only biped had. There was one more thing trailing behind the constructs. A hunched cryptic emerged. His body was flaking in ruin. The oxide tinted his every joint. The rusted texture covered the entire surface of his body. I could each step he took into the room. It was like sandpaper scratching away at a rusted piece of sheet metal. He sputtered out sounds that were not words. He quickly stood before Phileus and bowed completely before his legs gave out. He was on his knees. He let out sobbing sounds, though no tears left his single ocular. His voice was soft and cracked with static. So long have I waited. I have done my best to preserve what I have been able to. I couldn't help but notice something at his hip. Amongst all his essence totems that marked his mastery discipline, had been a belt of four tesseract labyrinths. I knelt beside the old cryptic and set a hand on his shoulder. You need not worry a second longer, Nehebkor. Your fallen brethren shall be awakened soon enough. I reassured him. He gripped my essence totems. Looking up to me he spoke indignantly. I thank you. My whole dynasty thanks you, my lord. Please, allow me to take you to my Pharaon. His voice was shaken, as if in disbelief at what he was seeing. Of course, but might ask. I gestured to the belt of tesseract labyrinths at his hip. Those have been used to stave decay. He gives a slow creaking nod. Of the materials on hand I have preserved many overlords and cryptics who could not remain in the Pharaon's own stasis chamber. He admitted. Lead the way. Phileus ordered. The cryptic nodded and quickly slinked into the back of the chamber. He walked with a slight limp. Our group marched after him, though Phileas lagged behind for a moment. She was eyeing the ceiling for a moment. In the meantime, Nehebkor spoke to me. "My lord, if I may inquire, how was it that you came to discover my planet was in need? Without power, we were unable to contact any of the distant Tomberlords. And being such a lesser-known dynasty, I did not expect help to come. I foresaw it, Nehebkor. I saw your mangled body ravaged by age and decay. I witnessed a future where the green tide plagued this world, where you would die alone in your decay, your entire dynasty in ruin. And I destroyed that future. Your people will not suffer decay a day longer." The old cryptic clutched his staff, resting his forehead against it. "Kugak. I can't thank you enough for that, my lord." He was once more brought to the verge of tears. I set a reassuring hand on his shoulder once more. "You will have time to rejoice when your Feren is reawakened once more. We must have passed at least 300 Lich Good standing sentinel before arriving at his Feren's resting chamber." A dull distortion covered the back of the section. It was like Trazin Stasis chambers on Solemnace, but far less stable. The Feren only had the most dedicated of his allies within his own chamber. His body was littered with holes where age had taken a toll on his body. "Phileas, could you let the others know it's time to move to phase 2? I was going to begin the rites of awakening, which if it was just for these two, I could easily wake them all within a year. But if I wanted to disable myself for a few days, I could instantly resurrect them all. Would a second resonance cascade be okay here?" "Be sanit. Executioner Phileas has instructed that we were to move to phase 2. This means she had found the highest dynastic representatives. With the Scorpioid joining us, we were to transport the power generator to the planet's core to kickstart many of the tomb systems. When power would be restored, we would have time to begin properly restoring the entombed Necrons." Quelka was quite eager to begin his works. He did have a greater number of Canoptech constructs, Lord Ishska. "In other news, Lord Trazin has already collected numerous creatures. At the rate he is going, he will rush through the reserve of Tesseract labyrinths I've made for him for this trip. Be high, Metallurgist Quelka. Sanit and a host of my finest animated, in body only, cryptic companions have delved into the deepest recesses of the tomb world to plant our generator. I have overseen various crucial excavations while his Lord Ishska oversees the resurrection of the highest court of the tomb world. Over the course of these last 2 years, much progress has been made in eradicating the abominable organic matter that has blighted this tomb. I can also say I have recovered several stores of Blackstone from their vaults for later use. We are actually on track to restore this world ahead of schedule thanks to the excavation constructs." Ishska admitted to me these constructs were designed specifically for the purposes of excavation and exploration. "But I don't believe he would have his constructs burrowing to the heart of a tomb world. Be Feren Narmerth of the Hemanth dynasty. Ours is descended from dynasties whose names are so ancient that few of their own can recall them. We of the first, of the enduring, have served each silent king stalwartly. We fought for him for generations and bled for him when we came to blows with the old ones. We lost billions, and lost worlds in that failed campaign. Even still, we followed the Silent King into the flames of biotransference unflinchingly. We fought the old ones, the Kroaks, the Ildari, Slan, Jokiro, and so much more. We sailed across billions of stars and fought, bled, and died by the billions. We had campaigned across the expanse of the stars until we knew there was war. What else was there? We had already given the Cetan all that was our being as the Necrontid. We had lost our people, we had lost our closest allies, our loved ones, and that everything that made life worth living for those few fleeting years before our cancers took us. We had wished for immortality and the immunity to the diseases that afflicted us so that we may indulge some joys in life. Why had we been punished for wishing for an existence not filled with suffering? I did not know, and truth be told, I had ceased thinking of such questions. When our war ended with the Cetan, we knew that our time at the galactic forefront had come to an end. We would sleep during the Ildari's dominion of the galaxy, to wait a day when their empires crumble, and are long forgotten. Our tomb worlds were reshaped, remade. No longer did we have cities, places of worship for forgotten gods of the flesh times, no longer did we have the temple of the immortals. All had been carved away. And into slumber we went. I was amongst the last to enter my sarcophagus. I watched as each of my lords under my command went to sleep, so many of my most cherished allies had been lost to me during our eons of warfare. I could bring myself to cry for them, or the tens of billions of my people we had lost. We numbered just under 400 million, perhaps the smallest of dynasties after the war. I had watched my last son entombed into his sarcophagi, the ravages of crocs had taken all my other children. I held what had remained of my wife, my Ferax crescent-shaped crown. Even with the feeling of love was taken from me, I could still feel longing. At last I moved to my own sarcophagus. Crawling in, I folded both arms across my chest. For an eternity of loyal servitude I had only known loss. So far gone we had become that I made blasphemies with my final waking moments. I cursed the Silent King's name. I slept undisturbed for ages. But as the ages passed, something was off. Modes of consciousness came in waves. Pain racked my body in those brief moments of lucidity. Something did begin to rouse me. A burning sensation. An all-consuming electricity. Atoms popping into being all around me. When my eyes came open, I found a high-ranking Praetorian, my cryptic Nehibkor and another I did not know carrying a balefire towards other caskets in the chamber. My form was rusted, patchy and flaking, but this balefire was rapidly renewing my necrodermis. My tomb had been in ruin. Tossing my mind into the surrounding systems and saw what had become of it. What I saw made me scream. No tabletop RPG is complete without beautiful models on the table, and the best place to get models is from us. If you check the link below, we have everything you could need for your magical realm. Only the finest of big titty wafers here. But if you're not into models or don't play with models, we got you covered with subclasses such as the Gachimashi Wizards, the Simp Warlock and the North FC Fighter. Also, we have started selling 5th edition adventures, with our first one featuring Belle Delphine, the succubus that has poisoned the town's well and turned the villagers into simps. If any of that stuff sounds fun to you, go ahead and check the link below, but let's get back to the video. Beishka. I've spent the past 3 years resurrecting the nobility of the Hemanth dynasty. Their Feren immediately awoke in agonized terror. I was concerned he may have been down with one of the viruses, but no. As it turns out, seeing your entire tomb world in a state of ruin will send you into agonizing terror and anger for an entire 2 entire weeks. After he was calmed down by his cryptic and Phileas, he was escorted to the surface. I was still busy rousing nobility within the tomb, which was naturally taking its time. In other news, the generator was a few months away from activating, which would seriously help with the decay. More and more collapsed tunnels were being cleared. But still, even with 3 years worth of burrowing, we had only made estates worth of tunneling in that amount of time. Quelka and Sana did eventually reignite the planet's core. Power did come back slowly. One by one, stasis chambers across the world were coming to life. With the decay now halted by the stasis field, Quelka's scarab set to work reknitting the necrodermis shells of the upper Necron ranks, slowly moving down the ranks as he did so. That certainly made my job easier. But crunching the numbers, I would be here for at least another 368 years. Which, I know I said I was fine if it took a few centuries, but come on. I tried thinking up ways to try and speedily resolve things. And my mind kept going back to the resonance cascade. In just the first year of power being on, I managed to reorken around 5 overlords and several dozen lich goods. Quelka had joined me in the effort. God, this was gonna be tedious. Even when we had the 200 plus individual Scorpioid units, this was time consuming. A portion of our Canoptic constructs had taken to repairing the constructs of this world to help further the effort, but we wouldn't see much of a tick in efficiency until we had more repaired the ones doing repair work. The logistics put this secondary subroutine of logic into a knot. Using what was esteemedly my second brain to mostly voice these ideas inadequacies to myself. I was still in the middle of conducting a reawakening ritual on a host lords. Up on the surface, our immortals and death marks had been busy with the megafauna responsible for the collapsing tunnels. Amphibious giants, saurian-type reptilians, and gargantuan things like swear reassembled purple worms. From the looks of things, they are in the late stages of evolution. Some mass extinction event would be nice. They were keeping our ground defenses busy, and Phileas had just wrapped up informing the higher echelons of nobility of the circumstances of their awakening. She really wanted to go up to the surface and join the ranks of warriors on killing some of these hulking brutes. In other news, Sanat was setting up to prep the dimensional gate to my Tombolot. That was going to take at least 3 decades to set up. For now, I just kept on waking up the seemingly endless chambers of overlords, cryptics, and lich goods. I stopped my secondary subroutine in charge of mentally complaining and got back to it. 2 decades had passed of constant resurrections. It wasn't anything flashy, their belfire barely lasted a few months. I couldn't dedicate myself to ensuring each of them would wake up, and each of them woke with a decade's worth of belfire power. Instead, I shortened my rituals and found the right balance. We had woken just about every member of the High Court of the world and most of the lich goods that defended them. All in all, that accounted for a little over 5% of the world's entire Necron population. Just another 348 years to go. After all this work, I really want to catch something to eat. I miss being able to taste. Quelker has finished half of his work on 1/4 of the world's tomb. Roughly 1 million Necrons have their necrodermis shells restored. The only reason he was able to do that so fast was thanks to my constructs helping reach so many of the tombs. He plans on stopping for a decade to produce more of my constructs to help him excavate the remaining 3 million fallen chambers. Work on fixing the tomb complex has been progressing fine. We have a Russia-sized portion of the greater tombs uncollapsed. We will actually really need all those constructs Quelker is about to build. There is still so much more to do. Sanat eventually does on the dimensional gateway at year 40 of work. When the portal is opened, the Lich Good and Overlords are evacuated to my Tombworld. Phileas has a Treok to keep them in line on my Tombworld. We get a load of resources sent our way along with a massive influx of Canoptech constructs to aid in the effort. We may actually get this done faster than intended. Unfortunately, we can't keep the gate open very long, it's a massive drain on the power generators. As such, we can use it sparingly every few years to transport the refugee Necrons. Trazin used this opportunity to head back home to gather his own additional supplies. I just hope doesn't steal too much from my world. Beferin Narmerth of the former Hemanth dynasty. When my dynasty was awoken, decay had racked the form of every citizen of my Tombworld. The bacteria of the world had evolved to such a degree that it ate away at slumbering forms when our stasis systems failed. We had been decaying for at least 5 million years. Added to that, megafauna had evolved to burrow in and around structures, stressing the stability of our tombs. Perhaps it was because of the burrowing that our stasis systems failed. I cannot say. My cryptic Nehabkor had tirelessly worked for the last 2 million to preserve our world. With no power, he was only able to so much. In the end, he locked my closest companions and lords within a chronal dispersion field of his own making. Our bodies locked in time while he worked away. The awakener Ishka had been the one who awakened me. He had raised us free from the decaying touch and mental degradation that plagued our kind, I am told. He was accompanied by one of the Treok Praetorian. He seemed overly familiar with Executioner Phileas, foregoing the use of her title in its entirety. I had seen many superiors to this cryptic cut down for lesser transgressions in the past. He continued to work diligently, his work obliterating the decay and occasionally returning slivers of personality, if not entirely returning them when they woke. I have not thanked the cryptic. Our restoration had come at a cost, proactively decided for my people. Our world was uninhabitable with these necrodermis eating microbes, and our numbers so depleted we would be assimilated into another lesser dynasty. The Voke had, I'm told, Beavral Ulthrable, warlock of the world Myrosilian. I have spent my 3,000 years in mostly carefree joys. I have indulged in travels across the stars, learning my people's history, enjoying all that my people have to offer. I have eaten foods by the greatest chiefs across 100 worlds, heard symphonies from across our empire that brought millions to weep, seen the artisanal work that quite literally transcends reality in its beauty. I have heard the voices of my ancestors in the spirit stones of our family's reliquary. I often listen to their guidance, the wisdom of ages. It was my family's matriarch of 10 generations long gone that pushed me to take up the path of the warlock. It was a talent our family excelled in, so I came to spend the next 900 centuries after my 3,000 years that I began to walk the path of the seer. I had risen quite high on my path as a seer, achieving the rank of warlock on my 4th century. I learned the powers of precognition, wielded them, honed them to a precision edge. Under the tutelage of my family matriarch Spirit Stone, I could very well ascend to the rank of Farseer. I saw the stream of time as branching roots of a tree, trailing the trunks and splitting branches. I could dance along my future paths as I saw fit. In moments of intense clarity, I could intertwine the branches of the future into a singular timeline. Still, I knew more could be done with my powers. I could see years, decades, even ahead into the future, dictating those years in ways that gave me every opportunity for success. I used these powers to receive a seat among the Seer Council of my world. I was amongst dozens of seers, and the handful of Farseers. Many had foregone the discipline of precognition. The destructive powers of war were far more appealing and readily measurable in terms of potency. I did not concern myself with such things. I could see the paths that my fellows would walk on. Most would not rise from their petty spaces on the council. Some would leave for other opportunities, and the rare few rose to the rank of Farseer. I was slated for that glory. I simply needed to raise my precognition beyond a few centuries. And so I sought to see what the next 1,000 years held in store for me. I traveled my own future, witnessing much. I saw many worlds caught in minor squabbles with the Orc. I foresaw much on my people, fewer individuals walking in the paths of the seer. I saw a rise in pursuits to push for grander heights in entertainment. Louder music, more decadent foods, greater heights in the artistic. We were reaching a renaissance age. But something stirred in my visions of the future. Our immortal enemy ripping its way through our webway. I pulled myself from the visions, my body unsettled by the visage of the silver skull with eyes of balefire. When I settled myself, I tried once more to glimpse the future. In the centuries and millennia of what was to come stirred me. The immortal enemy was rising in their slumber, exploring the stars. They claimed worlds, waking in greater numbers. I could not comprehend what I saw. Stars were stolen, moons of the blackest stones tore at the realm of souls, and at the center of it all, a cyclopean skull. He flickered with a blinding light, at once a being of metal and a being made of starlight. I shrieked in agony, until my breath left me, and slumber took me. Be me crypt boy Ishska, now unanimously known as the Awakener. I have spent the last century resurrecting Necrons. Do you have any idea how tedious this has been? I in the last century have awoken well over 1 million Necrons. My fucking resurrection orb matrix is fucking overheating, so now I can't take a break, but holy fuck man. Trazin did come back a decade after he left with so many more constructs. Just a few weeks from the end of the first century, we were actually able to rebuild the collapsed tunnels to allow Quelker access to the remaining 3 million Necrons that were buried. He managed to clean up the remaining Necrons' living metal, banishing the rust. So it was going to take a few months before my orb matrix would cool down, so I finally headed up to the surface after a century. I made the several days long trip to the surface, which gave me a nice bit of perspective on how radically things had changed on the inside of the tomb. Where there had been collapsed tunnels was now foundations of structures, and dozens of cryptex working to gather every relic, data scroll, and item of dynastic significance. When I reached the surface, I was met by a clear stretch of grasslands for miles. Every tree from here to the miles off where our ship was parked was picked clean. I headed off towards where our ship was parked, passing by occupied constructs moving to and from the tomb. Everyone was still working even when I wasn't. I eventually arrived at the collection of our ships. Set up between all of our ships, I found Quelker and a slightly scratched up Phileas discussing something. When I made my approach, I gave a coughing sound to indicate my arrival. I take it everything is looking good? I asked. Quelker nodded. Yes, so well in fact that I believe it's time I take my leave. I shall be overseeing the construction of your Scorpioid constructs and their distribution across the larger dynasties. They have been quite crucial to this operation, I admit. He seemed a bit reverent when talking about them. The old cryptic rose to his feet and patted my shoulder as he passed by me. I eventually looked back to Phileas. She had a relic scythe in hand. I take it you've been doing a fair bit of hunting? She gave a nod. She was running a molecular smoother over the edge of the power field of her relic war scythe. When I first read her doing so, it was because she was bored. Phileas, would you, by any chance, care for a game of Dawn of War? I asked her, slightly regretting asking. She halted her molecular smoother. The simulation. Yes, I believe I shall take you up on that offer. She rose to her feet and made her way to my ship. That was Mike to follow after. We made way into an empty chamber. Here we would start up one table for a round of Dawn of War. I ended up running orcs while predictably she ran Necrons. She was a highly trained professional who knew tactics and strategies that I could dream of. My only advantage was that I had an intricate knowledge of each unit within the game. The early game was grueling. I ran as a mech boss for my warboss. I planned on playing the long game, dedicating resources to setting up as many mech boy workshops across the battlefield. Phileas was quite aggressive, constantly setting me up to fall into an ambush of Deathmark spam. Holding any strategic positions also wasn't really an option for me. I knew she had been stockpiling something big in the first few months, which didn't really concern me. There is a certain beauty that came to the reality of orcoid combat. Orc vehicles were death traps, prone to being destroyed in smoldering explosions likely to destroy allies. There was, however, one incredibly cheap one transport which, with the help of a mech bot and a selection of mech boys, they could be mass produced faster than any other Lord of War units. To add to that, I augmented as many of the mech boy workshops in between, having my disposable units of death dreads augmented to keep up my ruse. After bleeding me of my death dreads and killer cans, she released her 5 Seraptech heavy constructs to swarm my base. I let slip my swarms of Dethrala battle fortress, each ramming into her units. It didn't matter to me if they exploded, as they only served to damage or destroy, as they were guaranteed to explode due to the destructive force of the Necrons. She couldn't shoot into the swarms of Dethralas, as it was viable to destroy dozens of her units. In the end, after a year and 3 months, I had detonated well over 60 Dethrala battle fortresses and claimed victory. When I pulled myself away from the table, I was surprised to find we had quite a following of Cryptechs and Constructs watching us. I have to say, Phileas, you play quite an aggressive lineup of Necrons. She didn't seem upset. Then again, I couldn't tell what emotions one might feel from a still death mask. She finally spoke after another few minutes of silence. Yes, well, you indeed waged war in quite the unconventional way. I let out something like a laugh. I suppose you're right in that regard. No orc mech boy would hold on to more than 2 Dethrala battle fortresses before deploying them right into the fringe. I relied on the fact that we had realistic orc vehicle detonations to take your key locations in a swarm of explosions. Quite, she held a disdain for the orcs, but perhaps after this she has learned a more effective way to fight against the orcs. I hope that round was enough to amuse you. I've gotten the charge back onto my resurrection orb matrix, so I can get back to waking the remaining 3 million denizens of the tomb. We parted with few other words, and had the lollygagging constructs double timing it to work on excavations. Quelka's small escort ship had already left. I headed for the bottom of the tomb world. I had another 268 years of work to do, and I wasn't looking forward to it. Although I was starting to think it was maybe time I finally tried it out. Even if it had been a frankly dangerous prospect. I made the half-week journeys to the planet Skor. Their few Serpotec constructs were still inactive. I had yet to have them reignited. I marched past them and headed to the power generator that had enough power to keep this tomb world active for millennia. The only thing that significantly drained its power was activating the Eternity Gate on the world. I felt it might be time I used it for my own end. I saw the massive energy generator, an ancient Necron device meant to power entire battle fleets, or in this case a tomb world. A snaking wire nest was connected to it, the systems of this world drawing its power from here. Every powered light fixture, every elevator, every one of the remaining 3 million stasis chambers, all of it was connected to this power source. I tapped in, streaming a sliver of my consciousness through the planetary systems, and watched the workings of billions of Canoptech constructs moving about the world. So much. I hooked a series of cables between myself and both the planetary operational consoles and the power source it was tapping into. I drew up my harp, lightly touching two chords. If I was still intermingled with the system, I believed my power could reach the entire planet. I held onto the waveform chord and the iconoclast chord for a moment longer. This very well would put me out of commission for a bit. How long that would be, I couldn't be sure of. Before, all I had was the ambient energy in the air and the resurrection orb matrix, which consisted of four orbs. I shrugged and finally strummed the chords in unison. Each of my atoms popped and transmuted. The living metal that made up my forms became greater once more. Once more I was blinded by the power of my body's apotheosis. Time came grinding to a halt as I was transmuted into a Cetan-like being. The connections rooted into the base of my neck were overcharged. The energy I had amassed was looking to spill over into anything else rather than allowing me to collapse and overheat into a resonance cascade event. Previously, my body couldn't contain all this power. I was too small of a container to contain all that energy. But now my power had an entire Tomb world to spill into. I spread my consciousness across the world. I inhabited every inch of the world's tombs. And with my body of light, I began to perform the rite of reawakening. Balefire surged through each conduit and cable. Every light fixture popped with the overflow of energy. The remaining 3,024,862 stasis sarcophagus was overtaken in Balefire. I could hear each construct that still remained in the tomb shriek in confusion. The four Seraptek constructs began to burn just ahead of me. It was beginning. Their great awakening was upon them. Every Necron that had been asleep for the past 42 million years was rousing to wake. I continued the rite of reawakening, my body moving of its own accord. I tossed up glyphs that I did not recognize. I slipped in algorithms chance of indecipherable meaning into the ritual. We had well surpassed the 3-second mark. 20 minutes had elapsed. I performed at unprecedented speeds. I occasionally saw flickers of other limbs manifest to complete parts of the rites that previously would have taken months in the span of minutes. I didn't have much time left as this being. The ritual was almost over after only 4 hours, and so I started a secondary subroutine. I had neglected to look into myself before. Far too many discrepancies about myself didn't add up. I saw each malfunction, the hallucinations I experienced, the movement of my mind ahead of my own actions. In the final minutes, I looked over myself with keen interest. As my consciousness began to fail me, I made one revelation. Much of my true memories had been removed from my being. I was incomplete. Well guys, hope you enjoy today's video. We are going to assume you have, if you have stayed to the end. Consider subscribing and clicking the notification bell if you really enjoyed it to stay up to speed with any and all new videos. Also check out the links below to our shop for some fat ass titties and our sponsor Rural, and be sure to use a promo code at checkout so they know we sent you and you'll get 10% off. And until next time.